the gospel story of Jesus' transfiguration. We normally have it in August when the sun is shining, and actually the sun is shining today. But one might ask oneself, not only why have we got the story of God's light and love for us in Jesus' transfiguration today, but also possibly the fact that, oh, don't we need it in these dark and difficult times? So, with those thoughts in your heart, let us sing our first hymn, hymn number 96 in your hymn books, if you would like to use those, or you can use the screen. Bright the vision that's delighted, once the sight of Judah's seer. To be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed.
to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so let us sing the Gloria from our service book.
And told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, but the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the second epistle to the Corinthians, chapter 3, beginning at verse 12. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not see the end of the fading splendor. But their minds were hardened. For to this day, when they read the Old Covenant, that same veil remains unlifted. It is only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when a man turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being changed into his likeness, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stand to sing hymn number 318, 'Tis Good Lord to Be Here.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter did not know what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said to him, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to it." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and the disciples kept silent, and in those days told no one of the things they had seen. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Moses had had an encounter with God, and in that encounter, the light and love of God was literally absorbed into him, so much so that his face shone. And when he came down the mountain, it was too much for those who were around him, so he put a veil on his face. We heard in our reading from Paul, to the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians, that actually in doing so, in a way Moses prevented the light and love entering others so that they might shine for God and shine for all that love and light and goodness. Beloved, there is someone in this world who has not just a veil upon his face, but I think he's in an armoured tank. And our world is suffering because of this darkness that has come upon the Ukraine. I have to speak into this situation as I pray, when I say in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, I pray I will convey to you a shining light of that which is God, which needs to happen. The light and love of God is the most powerful thing we have. It is that, and only that, that brings faith, and it is only that that brings hope in these dark times. And that, the difficulty here, is that light and that love is for everyone. But there are those who put themselves in tanks so that it doesn't get through. And when it doesn't get through, because damaged people sometimes have trouble receiving love, actually, those damaged people can go on to damage people. And that is what is happening in our world. But nevertheless, the light of God surrounds us all. The love of God enfolds us all. The power of God protects us all, because wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Even in the darkest places, God's light can shine and overcome it. When we are in the light, let us absorb that energy of love by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us take it into ourselves and shine as a light in the world. And that means being different. That actually means not only praying for the people of the Ukraine, all those who have fled, all those who have suffered, all those who have died. It also means praying for President Putin and his forces, that the light comes into their darkness and changes them and transfigures them. When Peter was up the mountain with James and saw Christ transfigured because of the almighty and immense power of God coming through him and radiating out, they too didn't have a clue what was going on, and they wanted to put Jesus and indeed Moses and Elijah in booths because it was too much for them. The point of God's love is, of course, it's too much for each of us individually. It has to be, because it is for everyone. And so the love of God and the light of God in Christ Jesus is the most powerful tsunami that we can spread throughout this world. And Christians are called to be different. They are called to hold light to those who are in darkness, to help take that veil away, to help gently ease them from the tank that they have surrounded themselves from. Now, I have no idea what Putin's background is. I don't know if he had a wicked father, or if he had problems in his childhood, or anything like that, or what has made him as he is. And this will sound strange, but I say it with God in my heart. He is a man above all to be utterly pitied, because he is dead to love. You cannot do these things if you have love in your heart. You cannot harm another person, or indeed the planet. I suspect that statement shocks you. But actually, unless we pray for people to be redeemed, unless we have the difference within us that is Christ Jesus, who suffered himself, and we all suffer, who died himself, and we all die, but rose again, so his living presence is here with us. You know, when we say wherever two or three are gathered together, there in the midst of us is the presence of God. Well, my dears, the presence of God is here mightily in Jesus Christ. As we receive the Holy Communion, it is us that is transubstantiated within our being. We have been nourished by eternal life itself in the communion. We have been given the means and the words, and we have been given the energy in the power of the Holy Spirit to do something that goes against the grain. None of us, hold my hand up, didn't want to pray for Putin. Didn't want to pray for the Russian soldiers that were causing all this strife and trouble. But unless we do, we will not have the hope and the faith and the love that God has given us in our existence. And everybody is entitled to that. So as we ponder these difficult things, as we take into ourselves the knowledge, the true knowledge of what it means to be godly and to be Christians in this world, by the power of the Holy Spirit, I pray we are given all that we need to bring peace. Amen. The choir will now sing, "Hear, O my Lord." choir. Thank you very much. So just a few notices. First of all, for Christian Aid, there's still a coffee morning next Saturday. Do go to it at the Spire Church. Support the Bring and Buy store. Also in Christian Aid, for Christian Aid, on Wednesday, starting on the 9th of March at 12 noon, there are various musical recitals at St. Thomas on the Bourne during Lent, and there will be a collection for Christian Aid as that, for that. On this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, so we will have a service at 10 o'clock at the Church of the Good Shepherd, and that's a special Ash Wednesday service which begins Lent. Therein, the Lent course will be on Thursday evenings in the hall at the moment, and it is Living in Love and Faith. And this is about learning to live with the challenges of people who are different from us in many and different ways, and it is about learning about different relationships. So please come. This is, I think, a pivotal time in the Church of England wherein we are trying to grow in seeing things differently, in being differently, in connecting and having a relationship in different and diverse ways. So please let me know if you would like to come. There is a booklet that goes with the course, which is a fiver. It's not essential, but it is actually quite useful, so it would be handy to know how many are coming, and I would encourage as many as possible to come. If we have too many people in the hall, we'll either do it in here or go to the Good Shepherd, where there's a bit more space. But please come on the course, because I think it is oh so relevant. So let us stand to say the Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So please be seated or kneel as you are comfortable for our prayers.
Dearly beloved Father, whose presence is love and peace, let us pray for all those involved in the turmoil in Ukraine, all the families who are fleeing the Russian tanks and guns, and those left behind who are prepared to take on the Russian troops personally. Offer them the comfort of your existence. Wrap your healing arms around all those who are afraid. May they be aware of your loving presence beside them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all the politicians involved in trying to find a peaceful solution to this conflict. Take away from their hearts hearts all the love of power and manipulation, and may they all see their duty as finding a way to unite all the various factions in this scramble for control, so that the guns and bombs may cease, and every faction walk away feeling that something valuable has been gained. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We bring before you, Father, all those who are sick in body, mind, and spirit at this time. As the God of love, we know that you care especially for all those who are suffering. Help them to be aware of your healing spirit, that they may be uplifted by your presence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. We thank you for the beautiful signs of spring which are making splashes of colour on the drought winter scenery. The snowdrops, the daffodils, the crocus, who all seem to be competing with one another at the same time this February. May we appreciate their beauty as a sign that, as Julian of Norwich said, all shall be well and all manner of things shall be well. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all churches and places of prayer around the world. We ask them to be filled with love and compassion and be places of peace where people can gather to experience the joy of your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Finally, Father, in a few moments of quiet prayer, let us bring before you all those known personally to us who are in need. Fill their stomachs, their hearts, and their souls with the peace of your Spirit.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So we now stand to sing the hymn 122, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds in Our Believer's Ear.
Jesus,
Jesus Christ, your living word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Send the Holy Spirit on all your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Thank you. let us pray with confidence the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Let us pray.
Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we who are partakers at this table reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and save. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Set us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And so let us sing hymn number 192. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring.
Amen.
During this difficult time when our church buildings are closed, we're still a church, meeting virtually for prayer services and fellowship, loving our neighbours by offering practical support to the vulnerable, and caring for our communities. The work of our church is reliant on people's generosity, a generosity that is a hallmark of a lived-out faith and a testament to it. We give to our church in a variety of ways, but with the closure of all our buildings, we cannot receive all the gifts that we usually would. So we really need your help now.